healthcare fire profiling across a leading health technology company, presented by Hans and David. And with that, I hand it over to you.
Yes, thank you, Alexander. Indeed, enterprise-wide fire profiling across our company, Philips, that we will gladly speak to today. Thank you all for attending already. So briefly, David Simons, I'm a principal architect in the Philips Chief Architecture Office. I've been with the company for 22 years and I'm based out of Eindhoven. And Hans?
I'm Hans van Amstel. I'm senior software architect at Philips. I've been working at the company for 8 years now as permanent employee. And before that, several years as a contractor.
Yep, thank you. So briefly, the contents that we would like to take you to today. I will kick off with the why. So the need that we see for enterprise-wide fire profiling in our company. Give a little bit about the context and the value proposition of the corresponding program that we have in place. And then Hans will take over and start to zoom into how we implemented that. On one hand, the actual creation of fire profiles, so the producing, the releasing side of the house. And also in the third session here, the consumption and the adoption of these profiles by our businesses in our products and solutions. So let's start with the first section. The strategy of our company is to deliver digital and integrated solutions across the health continuum to really join up the dots that exist in the fragmented healthcare landscape at times. You see that increasingly healthcare is delivered in ecosystems with a wide variety of stakeholders and players. So in addition, obviously, to the healthcare providers and the practitioners and the organizations around that and the patients and the consumers, there's obviously also a linkage to the payers, increasingly also an involvement of government and a shift to also consumer health. And that is actually the care continuum that as a company we serve with a spectrum of solutions. Solutions being compositions, combinations of products, services, software systems and devices. And that ranges obviously from healthy living to work it well, to being diagnosed at some point through treatment and interventions, and then discharge and ultimately also chronic care and home-based care. And for that, we have a number of businesses and we call them clusters: personal health, connected care, precision diagnosis, and guided image-guided therapy that deliver solutions with partners. And also we enable actually third parties to connect and to deliver solutions on top of what we've been calling the Health Suite system of engagement, which is a combination of platforms and platform capabilities that we develop for businesses to adopt towards providing this integrated set of solutions and also obviously from an efficiency perspective. But ultimately, to deliver ecosystem APIs and to deliver across our spectrum the support for dynamic workflows, for business and artificial intelligence elements, and for optimized and harmonized user experience, what is really needed is that you have semantic interoperability of the data and information that you process in these solutions. And that has been the scope of the program that I will talk about next. So I mentioned semantic interoperability. What is that? Why do we need it? Maybe superfluously. But it's really the ability of computer systems to not only communicate and exchange data, but to actually also use that information that has been exchanged and to understand it with an unambiguous and shared meaning. And what it enables is the actual use of data between those systems. I mentioned this dynamic workflow, intelligence, and user interface, and all of those you know, using data in a smart way can only be done if the data is semantically interoperable. So it's not only about specifying the packaging and the syntax, but also specifying the semantics and thereby the meaning of data and information. And so that's why we launched two and a half years ago, a program called ILS, the Information Language System within the company. And that is really aimed to govern the semantic interoperability of information across the spectrum of solutions that we release to the market. Huh? And that was driven by the fact that initially, both in the healthcare system, there's a large variety, but a very heterogeneous set of data available that's not necessarily accessible and that's not necessarily homogeneous. And also in the company, we were doing a lot of product-specific design of data models within the products, but also when you liberate the data for it to be used outside of the product. And the adoption of external standards like DICOM and FHIR was also done in product-specific and siloed ways. Huh? Adoption of standards does not per se mean that you all do it in the same way, and it certainly does not automatically imply interoperability. So that also translates to the data that you then have and collect and create in those solutions is actually hard to combine. And that's where really where we want to go strategically, as I mentioned, with analytics and clinical workflow and AI-based value propositions. So we need to ensure that unambiguous semantics and actually to do that by design. So we've been tapping into the R&D processes to get this higher on the agenda with the various groups. And we've been doing that by creating a community across the company, the Philips ILS community, where we actually team up with representatives and domain information owners from across the company. And with that community, we actually co-create in an inner source way of working, we'll zoom into that, these interoperability specifications. Common way of working, data models, terminology sets, interaction patterns also. And we do that both in the clinical type of data, right? So patient-related data about the healthcare status, but also operational data, operational of the healthcare enterprise, right? Utilization, scheduling, but also to some extent, linking to customer services related use cases. And then ultimately, obviously promoting the adoption and tracking the adoption in solutions in our products. And that's where we team up with the platform groups that I mentioned. Eh? If they start to leverage these specifications and implement it in the building blocks, that will also make it easier for the businesses to adopt it. And correspondingly, we tapped into the existing design and engineering processes to have the appropriate checkpoints. So with that said, early on, we realized that actually FHIR, the FHIR standard and the concept of FHIR profiling was a great basis to start and not start from scratch in parallel. The models that I mentioned, the specs are modular. It's not like we have one monolithic model. We really want to partition it. Huh? That's illustrated here with the orange blocks that depend that have a dependency on top of each other. And what this translates to, obviously, is FHIR profiles, profiles on top of profiles, which ultimately leverage concepts that exist already in the standard. Huh? The standard concepts and resources that themselves already define elements of semantics. And so we leverage those. We really promote through, and Hans will show that, leveraging the same base concepts or lower profiles that will ultimately also lead to harmonization across the company. But ultimately, you also need to specify when you go into specific application domains. Huh? And we didn't partition by business or organizational grouping. We really are constantly trying to stick to the clinical and the application domains, which are stable ultimately. Yeah? And we've been very much focusing on making these profiles universal, meaning that we can use them across the globe. But already we see that we might actually also need to go into national variants where we have specific markets or even customer specific elements as we work with customers in projects. So that is kind of a backplane behind these this diagram. Base standards common across the continuum and then within the application and then specializing it in the solutions. So the remainder of the talk, Hans will talk about then the way of working and that this community is doing. Yeah? But on the left-hand side, the creation of these ILS models to a large extent being fire profiles, the community producing it, and how we are publishing them and making them available on the right-hand side to the community of adopters that can find these available elements and adopt them in their product. Hans, if you want to take it from here. And go off mute. At the top, you can pull down the window.
All right. I think I'm audible now. Yes. Thank you, David. Indeed, I will continue this discussion through this picture. We'll need to start on the top where the ILS models are created by, we call them ILS producers, that are the one that does actually the profiling, and then how they enter by the consumers, so their businesses and the people that are actually going to use the fire profiles. Yep. All right, that's better. Yeah, David just discussed about, talked about why there is a need for enterprise-wide fire profiling. I will continue now with the first topic on this part. That's how actually they are being produced and how we're actually releasing our profiles. And I do a bit of discussing which tooling we use for that. The fact that we actually created an enterprise-wide level domain. How we looked at versioning within our profile stack. I will show you how our archive looks like and why we set it up in the way that we did, and also what we do about validation, so ensuring the quality, so that we make sure that the profiles are correct and can be used, and how we're producing development builds and release builds. All the business created their own profiles almost independently, and we saw that we had a couple of that the interoperability was lagging, for example with the adoption of the fire profiles, and some issues that we recognized were the syntax of many fire profiles was not correct. We definitely defined a problem with versioning. I will go into that a little bit later on. We saw inconsistency of profile names, for example, different casing that made it very confusing to work with the profiles if they all look differently. And also, what we did with the package that we released, we just took our profiles in our archive and zipped it, and that were our release artifacts. That gives some adoption issues. But we also found out that finding the correct documentation was really hard in such an environment. Our canonicals, for example, did not resolve. And also, if we found the correct documentation, or if we found documentation, it was not really clear if it's up to date. So when we looked at this whole landscape of interoperability issues, so to speak, we actually thought, well, this looks like all the issues that we also face within software engineering. So for us, it became clear that fire profiling on the enterprise level, it's very much like software engineering. You face the same issues, and maybe you can also apply the same solutions. Going back to the picture, I will first discuss the first part, which is now highlighted. That's actually how the profile is created, how profiling is done, and which tools we are using for that. For example, we use Forge. We use Visual Studio Code. And we use Enterprise Architect. Enterprise Architect is used for making the conceptual models. That will not be a further part of this presentation, but then the enterprise domain. We wanted to have all the profiles to look like they belong to the same system. So for that, we defined the domain, an enterprise-wide domain within Philips. That's www.fire.philips.com, and that's the base of our canonicals. And currently it's only Philips internal, it's private, but we are looking to first selectively share it with externals, and then as a next step, maybe even to opening up to the public, so that it will be completely open. And also what was very important was that all our canonicals and URLs are resolvable, so that when you want to find documentation about the profile, you can actually just copy the canonical of the URL in the browser and you will find a nice page with all the documentation on it. Well, how do our canonicals actually look like? Well, here are two examples. I think a couple of important parts to note is that every canonical starts with HTTPS. So we don't use HTTP anymore. Everything is HTTPS. Here is our base
Did we lose you?
Hans, are you back?
Hans, can you reshare your slide, please? And go off mute. Thanks for your patience.
Am I audible?
Now you are. Yeah, if you reshare your screen, we will proceed.
Yeah, something went horrible wrong here. Started auto-updating, it seemed.
Yes.
All right, thanks. Sorry for this. I don't know what was happening. We actually identified three type of versioning. There was the Fire specification version, the base version, so the R4 and SU3 and upcoming R5, of course. And we also identified that every profile has a version, so all individual profiles could be versioned or can be versioned, and also of course the version of our releases and our release packages. And if we dive a little bit deeper into that, the Fire specification version. We are currently on the latest technical releases. So that we have 3.0.2 and 4.0.1. You can find them here in the profiles and here. And also the base specification is in the canonical, as I just showed you in one of the previous slides. And also, we have multiple Fire specification that we support. So currently in our releases, we support both R3 and R4. Because some businesses are already working with 4 and some are still on 3. And of course, as an enterprise company, you also have legacy systems that you still need to support for a certain time. So we do support multiple Fire specifications version at the same time. And upcoming will of course also support the R5 in the future. The next type of versioning is profile versioning. Initially we started with having every profile have its own version. For example, a profile could have version 1.0.3. But we noticed that there are a lot of dependencies between profiles, because you have the base profiles and the derivating profiles. but also, of course, all the other kind of relations like subject and all the relations that are existing. And keeping then the semantic versioning up to date, that's really, really hard. It can be done, but it's very cumbersome and very error prone. So we thought of another approach, and that approach is not really to version individual profiles, but to version all the profiles as a complete set. All the profiles have also been tested and been validated together. So we decided to version them as a whole set. So you can also, as a consumer, as a user, you can see by looking at the version, if they have the same version, they belong together. They've been tested together. And this version is inherited from the container package and is set during our build and release process. So if you look in our archive, you will see that all the packages versions have been set to a temporary string, which is called package_version. And when we make our release, this one will be finally replaced by the actual release. Now, how does that actual release look like? Every quarter we have an official release. And the naming scheme that we use, the versioning scheme, is the year combined with the quarter and a patch version. That means that the upcoming version will be 2020.4.0. And we use this for the complete set. So all the packages together, but also for the individual packages. And also for the profiles, as I just showed you in the previous slide. And of course, it's also present in the package.json file. Some examples could be, this is one of our release packages, com.philips.fire.r4.common, and then the version, -2020.3.0. This is a package that we just released somewhere in September. And it's from the R4 spec, and it's one of our common packages. Well, how does our archive actually look like? Our top level is called Fire, of course. Then we have something that we call the realms that are universal, US and the Netherlands. And most likely this will be extended in the future. And if you look then into the universal, you will see the Fire specification. So in this case, we've got a 3.0 and a 4.0. And this is, of course, R3 and R4. And if you drill then a little bit deeper, you will see the different domains. You got a common, which is common over all our clinical domains. And then as a clinical domain, you will have, for example, cardiology, inpatient care, oncology, personal health, etc., etc. And this archive is currently in TFS, but we are looking towards moving this towards GitHub. But this will be something for next year, most likely. But how are people actually looking using this archive? For that, we also looked at the software engineering techniques. And we choose to use the GitHub flow. That means that when a new feature needs to be developed, first a branch is created. On this branch, you can start committing your changes. And once you say, well, this feature is actually now looking to be complete, you can start to create a pull request. And know that this is a request, so this is not actually the merging back in the master archive, but just a request. And creating this request allows to have this reviewed and discussed. And then after this has been finalized and all the reviewers are okay with it, it can actually be merged back to the archive. So we merge the feature as a complete feature back in the archive. That's actually how we do create the profiles. The next step is, of course, how to make sure that the quality is correct. So how to make sure that the profiles that we create are correct, actually. For that, we use the following tooling. We have the TFS build pipelines, HL7 validator, IG publisher, of course. We use Docker as a support tooling and shell scripting to connect everything together. And as you can already see in the picture, we validate all our profiles per commit. So once someone does a commit on our archive, we start validating. And this happens on the master branch, but also very importantly on the feature branches. So even when you're developing your feature in your separate branch, you will have the benefit of those that validation job, which will make sure that your profile is correct, at least as correct as we think it is. And yeah, which kind of things do we actually validate in that validation job? We validate the canonical, the URL. So the syntax that I just described should be there, but also the uniqueness. So if someone creates a profile with the same canonical, which can happen, of course, when you start building a profile upon another profile, then if it's not unique, this will be flagged. We also check the description. We want to have a description in every profile, and the description should say something about that profile, of course. But we only test if it exists, because we cannot, of course, test if the description makes sense. That would be really nice if we could do that. Next thing that we check is differential versus snapshot. We want in our archive only differentials and not snapshots. Snapshots will be created during the release process. So we only want to have snapshots of differentials in our archive. Our last part that we check is the profile name, because our profiles are be called with the type in it. So with, for example, structured definition.xml. So we want to check if that's correct. And we do that by during this validation job, actually looking into the profiles and look at the root tag of the XML. All the profiles are on XML, by the way. And based upon this root tag, we can determine what the extension should be. So with the root tag is in our case the source of truth from which the extension should look like. And yeah, we also want to have all profile name lowercase, and that's something we also check. And then last but not least, we also want to know that if our profiles are syntactically correct. And for that we use the HL7 validator. We use that in a Docker container. And yeah, our output of our build pipeline looks then something like that. Here you see in the top line, you see that we checked the R3 version of the common domain. And yeah, for every profile is going through the HL7 validator. And yeah, in this case, it says that all profiles are okay. You see nicely how long it took. That also can be very indicative if you see a certain drop in time or a certain increase in time. You see here a list of all the profiles that went through that HL7 validator actually. And then when the whole build pipeline has run, we know at least that the checks that we at this moment think is valuable have been succeeded. This list grows, of course. If we in a real life situation see that still errors come through, we will extend, of course, the cases that we test for, so that the next time this error will be caught. And the second thing that we do in our commit pipeline is also upload it to a private simplifier project, so that developers can easily look and investigate it using the simplifier environment in the profiles. That's how we ensure the quality. A second part that I want to discuss about is how do we actually create our release artifacts. For that again we use Docker. We use TFS build pipelines for the release pipeline, of course, and we use Artifactory. Artifactory is the host where we host our release artifacts, and we use Node npm. That's our tooling that we create our npm packages with, our far npm packages. And we also use the Torinox tool, and Torinox we use to convert our profiles from XML to JSON. In our archive, everything is XML, I think I previously mentioned. And the Fire NPM specification says that it should be in JSON. So we use the Torinox tool for that conversion. And again, we use shell scripting to make all the magic work. For the creation of the release artifacts, we use one pipeline. And that one pipeline can create two types of releases. One is our nightly release, and one is our quarterly, or also called our official release. Our nightly release is created every night at about 3 o'clock Central European time. And that's actually used for iterative development. It takes the latest greatest of our archive and it builds release packages out of it. But because it has gone through our complete build pipeline and also the validation pipeline, we know that it's syntactically correct, but could be and most likely is semantically incomplete. So features could be half there, or profiles could not be complete. But at least you can use it in an iterative development environment. You can recognize these with the dot that dosh with the snapshot prefix. I have a picture of it in a slide later. And of course, you use the npm fire npm package format, the fire npm package. Our second type of release, that's our really our official release. And that one is really for use in products. That one is syntactically correct, but also it's semantically complete. So once you have a feature developed that you want to use in a product, if you pick up the latest official release, that feature should be in there complete and can be used to build your product on. And of course, it's also in the Fire NPM package format. Well, how does our release build pipeline looks like? You will see the same three steps for every package. First, of course, we create the snapshots. So from a profile, a snapshot is being created. But because it's an XML profile, it will create an XML snapshot. And then we convert it into a JSON. That's this step, the JSON generation. And for the JSON generation, we use the Torinox tool. And then the profile or the snapshot profiles are ready for creating the NPM package out of. And that's, so that's the third step where we actually do the NPM publish. And yeah, for that we use the NPM tooling. So yeah, we use NPM publish in the Node environment. So this build pipeline, I cut it a little bit short here, but it's a long list where you see those three steps repeating for every domain that we have. And also you see the difference in timing. So that's also very indicative how everything went. This is actually quite a long step. As you can see that even one, they took 22 minutes. That's actually how did we produce our Firewide profiles and how we ensure the quality. And the next part is, how actually are those profiles being used by our consumers, by the businesses? So how did they pick them up and how are they, how can they find the correct documentation about it? How can they learn about it? Then we go back to this picture. We just discussed the left part of the picture, and now we will focus on the right part of the picture. And for that, we use the following tooling. We use, again, of course, Artifactory, because that's where our packages are hosted. The NPM tooling, because the tooling that can build the packages can also be used to pick them up from Artifactory. And of course, Simplifier, SharePoint, and a browser for the documentation. This is how our archive look like. Here you can see for one package, the R4 package, the common R4 package, you see all our previous releases. So you see the 3.0 from last year, the 4.0 from last year, and then we start from this year, 2021. This one was our previous release, which we did in September. And this one is the upcoming release. And here you can note the dash snapshot. So this one is not complete. We will release this one somewhere in December, most likely last week, just before the Christmas holidays. So then the snapshot will be gone and it will be an official 4.0. But then almost the day afterwards, of course, we will have a 2021.5.1, 1.0, of course, because then we will start working towards the next release. People can pick them up using npm install. Just use this is our registry, and then they install our latest version they pick up the release artifacts, the releases. This also uses all the dependencies. So this of course depends upon the base fire standard, and if you have the domains, they will depend upon this one on the common, and that will again then depend upon the base fire npm packages. And also make it certain that this is accessible for all people within Philips. So if you are a Philips employee or you access to the Philips network, you can pick them up. Everyone will have read access on it to increase adoption. Of course, documentation we'll put on Simplifier. For that, we have an enterprise plan. And we upload all our resources so that developers can easily inspect and search for these. That's a nice environment, so you can learn very in a nice, friendly environment about those profiles and look at them. One of the puzzles that we still have is we want to see how we can improve the integration between Simplifier and our custom-built NPM packages. For example, you see here a direct link towards our Artifactory. And it would be nice, of course, if you could put our packages over here, so it would fit nicely within this environment. Of course, we also built an implementation guide for every of our releases. Again, that's accessible internally for everyone. And it's also accessible using our Canonical on our top level domain. But then, of course, not with the profile behind, but with IG/common. In this case, it is an implementation guide for our common package. Again, all canonicals are resolvable. So if you want to see a page like this, just copy the canonical or the URL from the profile and copy it in your browser. And you will see something like this. We made sure that it looked very similar to our Firebase resources. So if you go to the Fire site, you will see you have a look and feel which is almost the same as this one. The only thing that we did was we changed the red for Philips Blue, obviously. And all the documentation that you see here comes from the profile. So also the description is visible here. That leads to one of the steps that we want to make down the line. That we want to enhance this documentation with some more information. For example, the conceptual modeling. So we would like to see where this profile fits in the complete set of profiles, preferably in UML way. And also the other dependencies that are between profiles, things like subject and all the other relations that there are. And it would also be nice to extend this documentation with a more in-depth rationale than just that you can find in the description. Then the challenges that we faced in building this enterprise-wide fire profiling. Not all challenges have been met yet, but we're working on them. But one of the challenges that we faced was when creating a build pipeline plus way of working was that most profilers are not software developers. And then one of the things you see is then that especially branching and committing an archive needs some additional explaining. And definitely something that we see is that people asking, what does those build messages mean? That the mail messages from the build engine saying that the build has failed and how to handle that. And then, that kind of issues you see. But once we explain how it works, things went very well and people accepted very quickly. Another challenge that we have is opening up to the public. So we want not just have this profiles internally in Philips, but also externally visibly, because we also want to have, of course, interop with anyone else, and so it would be nice if people could look at it. But as you can imagine, as a big enterprise, you cannot just open it up and giving it away. So we need to find a way to do this. Another challenge is that we want to have centralized profile development, so to have one top-level domain and to have a clear versioning. Our versioning, I think, is working quite okay. It's not perfect, but it solves a lot of issues. And something that we're also looking at is keeping our tooling up to date. For that, of course, the Docker environment helps really a lot. It gives us an option to quickly switch tooling. But also if it's not working, to switch back. So Docker is really helpful in this part. And the second one is, I think I mentioned it quite briefly, is that we wanted also a dependency overview. And for that, we created a tool that could create images somewhere like this. And this is a tool that goes over all our profiles. and kind of builds a dependency diagram like this. So it takes the base URL of all the profiles and sees the relationship. And this is only a very small part of the picture because we have quite a number of profiles. So this is quite an extensive picture, but at least it gives us a nice overview of the actual state of the profiles. Another one of the challenges is, of course, with the validator. And then that there were sometimes some issues in it. Sometimes it was unclear. And for that, we should really compliment the community, the Fire community, especially on Zulip. People were really helpful in identifying the problems and sometimes fixing it, and something telling us that we did something that could be improved. And another thing that we would really are struggling with is examples. Of course, we have a lot of profiles, and it would be nice to give users examples of those profiles. We have handcrafted a couple of examples, but it's really very labor extensive to create examples of all the profiles. So it would be nice, and we're investigating, to have automatic profile generation. And also what we're looking now towards is a next step in terminology. So to have a centralized terminology, looking at should we have code systems in every fire specification, or to have just one code system that works for all the different fire specifications. So that are still questions that we're currently looking into. And also, how does that work with concepts, value sets? How we should handle that. So that's for us still a puzzle. Another one that is really nice to have is semantic validation. Of course, the HL7 validator and all the tooling can make sure that it's syntactically correct, but we would also like to see something that we can check if it's semantically correct. For example, in the profile could say that the max value is 1, and syntactically that can be perfectly fine, but maybe the use case, it should be max value is 2. How can we test that? And also there we could look into the software development environment. What are the parts that we now just looked at in this presentation? Now, David told about why we could have why we have a need of enterprise-wide fire profiling. I talked about how we actually did produce them, and then I think a big takeaway is that it's very similar to writing software code in traditional software environment. So with the GitHub way of working, or at least a defined way of working, producing developers build, so helping the businesses integrate faster, having a steady release cadence really helps, and also to have the package versioning to get rid of the versioning hell. And also very helpful for businesses, of course, that they have access to the packages, so they can actually download our packages. But also very importantly is that they can actually get the documentation and are certain that it's the correct documentation. So I think it's important to come back to this sheet. So initially we had all those adoption issues in fire profiles. And what we should now see now is that we have much better adoption of the fire profile because our syntax is of a much higher level because of all the validation steps that we do. Also, the versioning is now much more clear. Everybody understands it and then understands what is the next version, how it works together. And the consistent profile naming, that helps a lot with working with the archive and working with the profiles, because it's less confusing if things look the same. And also our release packages are now easy to find. Everyone knows how to pick them up, how to use them, how to integrate them. And we also make sure that people know where to find documentation. Also, of course, the latest documentation. Yes. You can find this during the remaining hours of dev days on the Hoover app, but you can also reach us using email. This is my email address. This is the email address of David. And I think now it's time for Q&A. Right, thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. I think we have time for one question because we have to switch over to the closing session quite soon. Mm-hmm. But maybe we can pick something up. I don't see any questions right now. There's coming one in. Is there is the dependency overview image tool based on reading fire resources, and it's in and is it open source?
It's indeed reading through the fire resources. So the tool goes over complete the archive only to a certain domain. So you ask to create this picture from, for example, the common domain of the cardiology domain or whatever domain you want to this image to be created. And then it looks into all the profiles, all the structure definitions actually. And it looks at the, takes the base URL. And no, it's not open source. It's created within Philips.
We may consider it.
Yes.
Thank you everyone for your attention. Let us know if you have suggestions and also if there are things that you would want to hear next time around that yes. You missed today.
Okay, thank you so much. And see you in the closing session.
Thank you, bye-bye.